Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim Alhamdulillah Rabbi Alameen Alhamdulillah Nahmaduhu wa nasta'inuhu wa nastaghfiruhu wa natubu alayhi wa na'udhu billahi min shariri anfusina wa sayyiati a'malina wa ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa dhu la sharika lah wa ashhadu anna muhammadan nabiyyu wa rasulullah. Seek refuge in Allah from the rejected enemy, Shaitan. With Allah's name, the most merciful benefactor, the most merciful redeemer, all praise is due to Allah. That's good. We praise Him, we seek help from Him, we repent to Him, we ask forgiveness from Him, and we seek refuge in Him from our own weaknesses, our own bad deeds. I bear witness there is no deity except Allah alone. He has no associates, no helper. He's independent. He's not dependent on anything in the creation. And I bear witness that Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is his messenger to mankind. Today, we're looking at a subject in Quran where Allah says, save yourself and your family. But we're looking more toward how Allah did it with Ibrahim. He explained to Ibrahim and guided Ibrahim as a way of guiding the rest of us to clarity. And he instructed Ibrahim in a way that is easy for the rest of us to grasp. And when Allah revealed the Quran to Prophet Muhammad, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he instructed Prophet Muhammad to follow what he had established by way of Ibrahim, the guidance that he established in Ibrahim. So he says, "Kul innani hudani." Rabbi ala sirati mustaqim dina qiyami milati Ibrahima hanifa. And he goes on and says, wa makana minnal mustriqin. So he was saying to Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, who revealed the Quran, that sometimes you have to balance yourself. Revealed the Quran to Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He said to Prophet Muhammad, say, that's in this ayah here, says, say, my Lord has guided me to a way that is straight, to the right, the religion, the right deen, deen akiyam, religion, the right religion. The way, when he says, he's saying the way or the path by which Ibrahim traveled. And Ibrahim was of the Hanif, Now, Hanif is used in the Quran several ways, but he continued to say there that Ibrahim was not one who joined God with Allah. So the stage is set, pretty much so. When Allah reveals this to Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, now he identified Ibrahim when he says Ibrahim Hanif. Hanifa. Hanifa means upright, it means do right, it means following what is right, it means that which you could understand to be right. And that was the nature in which Ibrahim was created, and all people were created, all creation was created. So Ibrahim was following that nature. He was following the nature in which Allah had created all things. So Allah says here that follow that way, the Ibrahim, the nature in which Allah created things. Say, surely my Lord has guided me to a way that is straight, the religion of right, the way of Ibrahim, the Hanifa. Hanifa is a word that's used not just for Ibrahim, it's used for the people of that time. The Hanif people were people who believed like Ibrahim believed, who believed and thought like Ibrahim thought. They were people of that time. So the Quran explains the Quran explained the situation, how it's to be looked upon. Now when Allah revealed this to Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, this is about the sixth ayah, sixth surah, on the 161 first ayah. And when he revealed this to Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, it was a way to, so Prophet Muhammad would be able to communicate this to us, because it was obvious that Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam had already been on the path of the Sirat al-Mustaqim. Not that he had been identified as Din al-Islam, but he had already had reached the level of human development that spoke to human excellence before he received the Quran. He didn't receive the Quran and then Quran guided him to human excellence. He had lived that part of human excellence that comes from the nature. Now you've heard the term Mother Nature. Allah has created this creation to serve like that, to serve. A mother, when we understand what a mother does, mother is not just a woman, a mother is not just a wife, a mother is not just a sister. A mother is that part of the creation that nourishes, is that part of creation that shapes and molds, is that part of creation that brings about and makes something and to the point where it could stand up on its feet. A mother is like a god. That the Quran, Huda Mustaqim, the Quran is a god. Like a mother is a god. So when Allah says he's shaped man, to be on the Sirat al-Mustaqim, that tells us that man, if not tampered with, if man does not step off the wrong end, man does not go astray, man will be able to stay on that path of Sirat al-Mustaqim and grow. Now, some might not quite look at it like that. Some might think that man is not capable of that. That's what Iblis said. Iblis said to Allah, when Allah says he's going to create a Khalifa, when he said he was going to do that to be the vicegerent, or to be the one who controls the creation and all of the creation, Allah told the whole creation, Malaika, to make sujja to his man, his Khalifa. But Iblis didn't want to do that, because Iblis did not have the belief. He had thought he had a better idea. He didn't understand that when Allah created the man, he created the man to go on the Sirat al-Mustaqim, to stay on the Sirat al-Mustaqim, to be molded by the Sirat al-Mustaqim. He didn't create man for no other purpose. He didn't create man to be devious. He didn't create man to be something insane. He didn't create man to be something that would govern other than what Allah intended for him to govern. He created man to be on the Sirat al-Mustaqim. It's in the nature of the human being to be on the Sirat al-Mustaqim. Each individual has this within our nature. Each individual. You don't have to think the group has it. This is not a group message. Allah wasn't talking to the group. He was talking to the individual. Individual form groups. And if the individual is not strong and on the Sirat al-Mustaqim, the group he belongs to can shape his mind and shape him to be something else. This is why it's so important for the individual to understand the Sirat al-Mustaqim, the nature in which Allah created us. This whole of the creation, everything in creation has to, by the command of Allah, aid man in the shaping of man. The whole of the creation has to aid man in the shaping of man. The term Mother Nature, that's what that's talking about. They came and understood that Allah's creation was a mother to all of the human beings, was a mother to shape man. Nature shapes man. Don't you know we couldn't even think a thought if we didn't look into the creation? If we couldn't see the creation, or if we couldn't see darkness or feel darkness, or we couldn't have no feeling at all to connect us to the creation, we wouldn't even have a mind. The mind that we have was formed by this creation, by Allah's command. Because Allah told the entire creation, he said, make sujja. And sujja, as that command goes, generally we just say it means bow down. No, but the way Allah expressed it, he says, fall down, absolutely, without any hesitation. And aid my Khalifa in the development of the Khalifa. You see, the Khalifa, the idea is to follow that nature in which Allah has blessed us with. And then that is what's going to help form society. Society doesn't form the human being. Allah warned us against that. He warned us against allowing the society to form us, or the culture to form us, or the community to form us. He warned us against that, because communities and cultures can get wrong. Look at the world, for example. You look at the world, you see all the different philosophies, all the different concepts going around, and they all claim they are right. Don't you know half of the world, I would say majority of the world so-called leaders and rulers, they believe they had the right process. They believe they had the right process to bring about peace. That's what they're doing. Do you think that the Russians don't believe that if they can get the world to submit to them, there won't be peace? Do you think the Germans didn't believe that? Adolf Hitler's whole concept was about that. Domination and controlling in order to bring the world into submission so it could live under peace under his rule. That's the Pharaoh mentality. Pharaoh did that. Pharaoh was the same way. Pharaoh, that story in the Quran and story in biblical revelation is about telling us the danger of man succumbing to his community, his nation, his ummah, his society, unless it follows Allah. That's the prime example. The prime thing is that every nation should follow Allah, not say la ilaha illallah, not that. Anyone could say that. Allah says people are judged by what? By their conduct. And then he said that then comes about what? Through their heart. The measure of a man is in his heart. So it's not about I can rule you and we'll be okay. It's not about that. It's about that each individual is supposed to follow the guidance of Allah. That's what makes it okay. That's what makes it okay. And if a society is formed under that premise, following what Allah dictates in Quran, and follow what Allah dictates in the nature of the human being, then that society can be formed a good society. That's the kind of society Allah called a balanced society. That's the kind of society Allah called a exemplary society. It's not a society to rule the people. You know, there's some societies that freedom of religion is not heard of. If you try to practice freedom of religion in some countries, you will be stopped, you will be locked up, or you would be killed because you want to follow religion. And it may be different than what they have. You may want to follow Quran. You may look in the society and say, okay, everybody here call yourself Muslim, but I don't think you really follow what I want to follow in the Quran. I think this Quran is saying that man should be respectful of each other. You saying that you think I got to follow what you say, even if it's not in of the will of Allah, even if it's not in Quran. I don't follow that. I'm not going with that. Now you take that position in some countries, in some organizations. You don't have to leave America. Take some organizations and you take that position that you're going to follow Allah, follow Allah's will. You will either be ostracized, killed, or locked up because they don't want that. They don't want a community that follows Allah. And do you know that the whole of the society should be following Allah? The whole of the society. There's nothing in about the society that's supposed to be a culture should make its own rules, its own logic, its own anything if it's not in conjunction with Allah's plan. See, Allah says in Quran, he planned, and so does the deceptive's plan. But Allah's plan is best. Society is run by people who want to control the masses. And they want to control the masses through their philosophy. Sometimes they use the Bible. Sometimes they use Quran. Sometimes they use Torah. Sometimes they just make up things and say, this is the way it should be. When actually everything is already laid out. It was laid out before the Quran. It was laid out before the Quran. If it wasn't laid out, Ibrahim never could have got on the right course. How could Ibrahim got on the right course if it wasn't in the nature of man to follow Allah? He couldn't have, because the Quran had not been revealed yet. There had been some other revelations, but a book wasn't even revealed to Ibrahim. But revelation was revealed to Ibrahim. When it came to Musa, revelation revealed to him, but it also was in the form of the Torah. So he had something more concrete to work with. And even with that, society still, men, not just society, men who wanted to dominate society would use that to their advantage to control the masses. Now, certainly, we have to form ourselves into a community. Because Allah says in the Quran clearly, when he talks about Ibrahim, he says Ibrahim was a community formed on the basis of Qiyam, formed on the basis of that it was a Hanif community. Hanif, meaning that they were upright, they followed their nature. They didn't have a book, they followed their nature, didn't have a book. All they had was this creation. And they believed in that. They believed that in this creation, Allah's message existed. They believed in this creation, Allah has guided man. So this is why they say, my Lord has guided me. Because they just said, it wasn't my parents, it wasn't my civilization, it wasn't my history, it wasn't what came around us, it was my Lord has guided me. And Ibrahim pointed out that the way Allah created him the first way, his nature, he was saying, in my nature. And this wasn't exclusive to Ibrahim. It wasn't exclusive to Ibrahim. We shouldn't see it as, oh, Ibrahim was special. Ibrahim was submissive. Because in the end of that, down toward the end of that, Ibrahim says that he when he says, La Sharika Lahu, then he says he was commanded by his Lord. And the last statement he says, I am Muslim. See, in other words, Ibrahim said that he followed his nature, and following his nature, he submitted to the will of Allah. That's what the word Muslim means, submit to Allah's will. He submitted his will to Allah, to Allah's will. And from that, the community of Islam began to evolve. A lot of is in the story of Ibrahim that sometimes we don't get a chance to go over, but it's very important that we look at. Even when they're building the Kaaba, building the house, and even in the Surah Al-Hajj, and when she was traveling between the mountains, looking for some water for her baby. And a baby under his foot, water began to spring up. And they call that, today we call that what the Quran refers to as the Zimzim, the fountain of Zimzim. And now many think that that represents physical water that brings about the purity of the soul. But what that represents, it represents the knowledge. It represents the knowledge of Allah is continuous. It's not something that runs out. It's continuous, and it purifies the soul. That's what purifies the soul. And it doesn't, and you don't have to go to the mountaintop. This is what they're saying. You don't have to go to the mountaintop to get Allah's revelation. It's beneath the foot of a child. Meaning that it's so basic. It's so basic, even before a baby can walk, that the knowledge is there. Meaning that it's in the nature of the human being. Before the human being even begin to rationalize with this creation, before the human being begin to think he can fly and think he can transplant hearts, before all of that, the nature of the human being is in there that Allah has created man to evolve on. So plain. So simple, but so important. The fountain of Zimzim is beneath your feet. It's your nature. And if you allow, and if you allow that water that comes out of that, which is Allah's truth, to water your nature, to water your nature, that Hanif, to water that, to bring life to that, then you will flourish as Ibrahim flourished. You will be able to flourish as an individual. And once you're able to be as an individual, believing in Allah, serving Allah, submitting to Allah's will, once we are able to do that as individuals, then it's easier to build a society. Because then the society will be built on respect for life. Respect for life. Respect for each other. This society nowadays is built on dog eat dog. It's built on who has the fastest draw, who has the more power, who has the gun power, who can overtake who. That's the kind of society we're living in now. That's the kind of world that evolved. But as the world begin to change and the new sun or the sun begins to rise for the first time in the West, as it did in the East, then the world begins to change. And the sun we are talking about is Allah's truth. Allah's truth. I know it may be hard to see it now, but the same as Islam rose in the desert of Arabia when men were killing their firstborn if they were girls, where you had thieves and robbers, where you had a society against everything that seemed to be right. Islam rose in that area, and Allah rose out of the desert in Arabia, the fountain of Zimzim, as another sign of his power, and a sign that in this day when we live in now, Islam is going to rise in the West with the same authority it rised in the East with. That's what Allah is talking about. And all of what you see today is trying to prevent that. Don't you know all of these stories that goes around about Islamophobia? Our people shouldn't be in that. We shouldn't let that stuff bother us. But the media trying to prevent Islam. I'm not talking about the prevent us from wearing jalabis and prevent us from wearing kufis. I'm not talking about that's symbolic things. That's not even the religion at all. That's not the religion. I'm going to say it in capital letters. That's not the religion at all. The jalabi, the kufi, the length of the beard, none of that is the religion at all. Allah says the religion is devotion to him. Salat, making regular salat, establishing regular salat, and zakat, giving charity. That is a religion, straight. That's what Allah says in Quran. Nothing about all those other things people attach to it. So if we following the religion as Allah has laid it out for us in the Quran, then we can begin to change and reshape the society in which we live and the world in which we are evolving. But we have to believe that. We all don't believe that, you know. There's some people who believe as some of our Christian brothers believe. Some of our Christian brothers or friends, whatever you want to call them, they believe that the rescuing of the world is going to come when a man, Isa, they call, come down out the sky riding on a horse, a winged horse, and he's going to have a double-edged sword. swinging it from side to side. They believe that that's the Savior. They believe that's the way it's going to happen. They believe that suddenly the sky is going to open and that's going to come out in the sky. But now, also, there's some Muslims who believe something very similar. You've heard the story of the Dajjal, the one that, it's not Quran, but the one they talk about that in the last days is going to be standing on one foot in the water and the other foot on land, got fire and water in the hand, and all of that is so symbolic and just have simple messages. The only truth that's going to come to you out the sky, your sky is your own mind. Your sky is your own mind. That's where everything for you happens. It happens in your mind. If it does not happen in your mind, it will not happen in your life. So that truth has to come to your mind. That's what it's talking about. Nobody riding out the sky on a horse. Nobody coming out and standing on the water. It's when the truth comes to your mind and you understand it from your rational thinking. You understand it from your moral position. You understand that, then that was what changed you in terms of the right side and the left side of doing right and wrong. And that action will change the world. It seems to be difficult to understand sometimes. But when you give in to what Allah has revealed to us, it becomes very easy. This is why when Allah says to the Malaika, make sujood to fall down, don't hesitate. Because then they can begin to see. But for us, that same principle holds. Even more so when we understand that story itself. When we understand that story itself is really talking about us. It's really talking about each one of us. Not just the jinn, not just shaitan, and not just Adam. It's talking about those entities that are in every individual. That causes an individual to follow Allah's right or follow what is wrong is in each and every one of us. That objection, where we say, well, I ain't gonna do that. That objection is in us. Oh, I don't like him. That's in each of us. That's what we have to get rid of. We have to close down the jealousy. We have to close down envy. We have to close down all of those things like greed and things of nature, what's going to hold man's development back. When we close those things down, then we can see the basic principles that Allah has for us as individuals. It's not as hard as sometimes we make it sound, or we think it is. It's very easy. Allah says he made this easy, so it'll be easy to understand and easy to talk about. And you forget whatever Allah wants you to forget, you're gonna forget it. You ain't not gonna remember it. But the Quran is your guidance. And Allah is as close to you as your jugular vein. You got to trust that. You should be walking as if you're the only person on the planet Earth and your relationship is with Allah. You have a personal relationship with Allah. We all do. Do you think Allah will let us not have a personal relationship with him and then call us and say to us he's our Lord? How can he be our Lord if we don't have a personal relationship with him? Your relationship is different than my relationship. Each of us have a different relationship with Allah. You think Allah is not big enough for that? Oh, you think Allah is too big to relate to us individually all over this planet Earth, the hundreds and thousands and millions and billions of people. Allah cannot relate to them one-on-one. Is that what you think? That's opposite. Allah relates to them one-on-one. And he relates to them as a group. He speaks to man, all mankind.
He speaks to men, all you who believe. He speaks to individuals as well as he speaks to groups. This is the power of Allah. There's nothing outside of his power. So we should have a personal relationship with Allah. When you walk around, you should feel like Allah is with you. You should feel like Allah is with you. You should be saying, oh Allah, help me get down the street. Oh Allah, help me get out this bed. I know you're here. When you're alone thinking about Allah, you know Allah is with you. That personal relationship. When you get ready to go on a deal or travel, ask Allah to be with you. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. When you start out that way, as an individual, with a personal relationship with your Lord. And Allah says, when you're guided rightly, can none change. Nobody can stop it. And when Allah's with you, there's none who will be against you. So we want to take a short pause. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين. أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. In closing, we want to remind ourselves and bring our attention to purpose. And bring our attention to purpose, collective, but as individuals. Each one of us, Allah says he could have created us all the same if he wanted to. He could have created us all the same if he wanted to. But he created us different, and just in that fact alone, we should be able to read that. We should be able to read that Allah created you different. That means there's nobody else ever been in history like you. There has to be a reason for that. There has to be a place you fit in the whole scheme of things. You have to be able to see yourself as an intricate part of the puzzle. Not just the puzzle to go home and sleep, but the puzzle to build the society that Allah is talking about. A purpose to bring about a new creation on this earth. The same world we live in now was a new creation. It was old now, but it was new. The 1400 years ago, they didn't see this creation. If they walked out here on this street, all of them, no matter what they believed, and saw this creation, it would blow their mind. And this is just talking about the dunya. It's not even talking about our behavior. The behavior wouldn't be real. Behavior is going on today. If the prophets and messengers saw this behavior going on with the everyday person, they probably wouldn't even believe this world even existed. They said, what? People wearing their hats backwards, people with their pants down to their ankles, men. Men acting like women and women acting like men. The world is just full up with this now. This is a different world than the world that was 1400 years ago. But Allah says this world is finished. This world is over. He's going to make another world, another earth, another earth meaning world, another society where people are dealing with Islam, Deen al-Islam. Peace as being not just a word we say when we greet each other, but as a behavior we have with each other. The behavior we have. That behavior is not just a handshake. It's not just a hug. That's not the behavior. Behavior is how we treat each other as brothers. Do we backbite one another? Do we promote one another? Do we help each other? Do we try to help those who don't even know we're trying to help them? Do we help those who just look like they need help? This is the kind of world that's being formed. This is why Allah has you here. Allah has blessed you to be part of this. He's blessed you to be part of this, and your reward is great. He said, you think you got it here? He said, yo, hereafter gonna be more and more. He talked about the corn cob. The corn, the ear corn. Hundreds out of your blessings will be just one blessing, multiplied hundreds of times. So you feed one person. Look at the blessings that Allah has prepared for you, waiting for you. Now you can believe that or not. But let me just say this in closing. The one thing you can be sure of, if you are not sure of anything else, what you can be sure of, you are here. You are here. So you know Allah can bring about anything he wants. So with that, we would say, Rabbin Natina Fidunya. Hasanatan. Akirati Hasanatan. Adabanari. Akina Adabanari. Our Lord, give us the best of this world and of the hereafter. And protect us from the fire. I mean, he comes.
Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, ashhadu anna Muhammadan Rasulullah, ayya rasulullah, ayya rasulullah, faqam fi salati, faqam fi salati, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, la ilaha illallah.
Donnell.